So the other thing that I am obsessed with is Masters of the Universe. It's something I have personal history.
You, Christian, never. What? You never talk about Masters of the Universe.
Well, I have personal history with it. I had it when it was in turnaround with John Woo. I don't know if you remember that back in the day. Dude, he had in the script, Kevin, he had this thing that said that Teela and He-Man were going out to get cheeseburgers. So, yeah. Yeah, so I went and it was in turnaround and I approached Susan Downey and this whole thing, we had this whole conversation and essentially had gotten it. My buddies had written this spec script for Wonder Woman back in the day, mm-hmm. and Jennison and Strickland and they had written this whole thing. Mark Riley and I got involved in it. We came up with this treatment. Long story short, Masters of the Universe to me was always like Star Wars meets Lord of the Rings. That was always kind of what it was. And then in 2002, they had that series that popped out. So can you, your show, the animated series on Netflix, it takes place after some of the events of the old school series?
Yes. Now the 2002, you're talking about the Mike Young show?
Yeah, the Cartoon Network one. Yeah.
Which I thought was absolutely wonderful in terms of like, they took all the IP, they created a new story. They turned Skeletor into Adam's uncle, if I remember correctly, Keldor, his name was.
Yep, and why his face went off and stuff. So yeah,
all the things they did, I was like, that's fucking pretty dope and stuff. When I got this job, my agent was like, Mattel wants to meet with you. And I said, Mattel, why? And he said, they're not saying, but they want you to go to their office. I said, where are they? And he's like, Santa Monica. I was like, that's fucking far, no way. And then they were like, it is. I mean, for those who don't live out here, Jesus. Yeah. So he said, they'll come to your house. And I said, all right. And he said, you just got to sign an NDA. I said, okay. Sign the NDA. So they come over to my house. There was one guy who had worked at Disney who I had met when I pitched Kingdom Keepers there. And I got that job. And so the dude, he just left and joined Mattel. So Rob David, who runs our division at Mattel, he'd been writing the Masters of the Universe comics at DC for a while and stuff. So not only is he like, you know, a suit, but he's also a creative. So that guy at Disney was like, Kevin Smith gave a really fucking fun pitch for Kingdom Keepers. Why don't you hit him up for Masters of the Universe? And Rob was like, he'd never say yes. So they come over and they tell me Masters of the Universe. And I was like, oh, what is it? And I mean, I know what it is, but what in what way? And he's like, we want to do a cartoon. He's like, look, there's a three-pronged approach that we're taking with Masters of the Universe and relaunching the world and stuff. One is a kid's show, and it's like a CG kid's show, and that's going to be on Netflix. He said the other is a big feature film with, what's the kid's name? Noah Centineo,
I think. Roxy, yeah.
Yeah.
That movie is happening, he said. But what we want to do is something for people who love the original show. He's going, because the kids show has a lot of the elements, but at the same time, it's very much a kids show, and they're not following the adventures and stuff like that. And he said the movie is, you know, doing what the movie's doing. He said, we want to give the hardcore fans who've loved this for years, like a show that they recognize and go like, that's it. We want to do a sequel series to the classic series. So I was like, oh, all right. Like, give me one sec. That could be fun. I was like, you know, I'll be honest with you. I watched Motu when I was a kid, but I didn't collect any of the toys. I was a Star Wars guy. My parents were poor to begin with, so I couldn't do two things. But I'm well aware of the show, well acquainted with the show. So I, you know, watched a few episodes, and there was one episode, very important, very integral. Like the show, if you remember, of course you do, doesn't have a fuck ton of mythology. You know, very episodic. But there was a little mythology, and there was like a storyline that they never quite finished. So that, you know, I was like, oh, let's seize on that and make a whole series about this. So I came up with a story, pitched it to Rob. He was like, fucking love it, man. Let's take it to Netflix. And I was like, it ain't going to get picked up, bro. And he goes, what do you mean? I was like, anytime I go to Netflix, I said, I pitched at Netflix maybe 10 times. Never. They've never picked up anything I've done.
Wow.
And I said, and even weirder is every time I've gone into Netflix to pitch something, I always run into, no bullshit, Ted Sarandos, like who I know from like back in the fucking Miramax days and shit. Yep. Like he'd been around for a while. And he's always like, hey, man, how are you? And I was like, hey, fucking how are you? And he chit chat for a second. And he goes, what are you bringing in? I said, oh, this thing. He goes, well, I hope they pick it up, man. And I'm like, yeah, all right. And I always feel good because I'm like, hey, fucking, if that guy says hi, I got to be in a good place. And every time, it never happens. Never gets picked up and shit. So much so that last time I went in there, like, I remember going, I was there with this hockey movie, the John Scott hockey movie with Mitch Albom and Mike Tolan. So we went in to pitch this hockey picture that's based on real life story about John Scott. So as we're in the lobby, and they got this big off lobby with video walls that show movies and shit, and suddenly you're in the Crown, suddenly you're in the Upside Down. It's huge. And it's packed. Like, at least this was, you know, before COVID.
Yeah.
So it looks like a New York subway, just full of fucking people. So we're standing there, you know, we check in, and then they tell you, like, someone will come down and pick you up. As we're standing there, they're like, how do you feel? Do you feel nervous? And I was like, no, I don't feel nervous, man. I said, I'll feel nervous if we run into Ted Sarandos, though. And they go, why? I said, every time I come pitch here, man, I run into Ted, and I always think it's going to be a good thing. But it fucking, and then all of a sudden I hear Kevin, and I fucking turn around, and it's Ted Sarandos. And I'm like, hey, man, how are you? And we chit chat. And he's like, what are you here with? I was like, a hockey movie with these guys. He's like, I hope they get it, man. Maybe I'll see you upstairs. And he left. And I told the guys, I was like, we can go home right now. And he's like, why? And I was like, that's usually the kiss of death for me. They don't pick up anything. So they told me we're going into Netflix. And I figured I'm going to go pitch He-Man. And I said, or Masters of the Universe. And I said, well, kids, that's where this falls apart, because they're never going to say yes, because they don't take anything from me. And then I heard the magic fucking words. And they were like, oh, this is already a go series. This is put. We're not pitching this. Netflix picked this up. And I was elated, because I was like, oh, shit, this is real. Like, I get approached by a lot of people who are like, hey, let's go in and pitch this thing. And, you know, they all seem to think because I've made things that I can get things made. And I tell all of them, I was like, you want to get this made? You should really become friends with J.J. Abrams. They make all of his shit. Like, introduce themselves to Jordan Peele. They make all of his shit. But Kevin Smith shit, the only reason you think that they make Kevin shit Smith is because I make Kevin Smith shit. Like, nobody else wants to and stuff. So it's an illusion of a career. Not so much like something you can count on. They're like, oh, Kevin. And never happens. Like, AMC, when I had the Comic Book Men show, I didn't pitch that to AMC. That just fucking happened accidentally, and we backed into a TV show. If I had went in and said, here it is, it's called Comic Book Men, nobody would have bought it. I can't pitch for shit. When I did that Kingdom Keepers pitch, like, I said to him, I went into the room, it was right before my heart attack. I said, kids, there was like 12 Disney execs. I was like, kids, with all due respect, I'm like 47. I've been in this business for like fucking almost 25 years. I was like, I don't like pitching. I'm sure you guys hate hearing pitches, but I wrote the whole fucking outline down. So what I'm going to do is, I brought my laptop. I'm going to read the pitch right off this, and I will look up at you from time to time if you feel we need to connect. But that will be the shortest distance to 2 points. And they're like, fucking go, you know? So I don't take shit very seriously because nobody ever does shit that I want to do. Yeah. But if I go in on somebody else's shit, that's generally when things happen. Comic Book Men was somebody else's thing that they were like, they want you to come in and talk about it. And I haphazardly was like, you should do a show set in a comic book store, never thinking about my own. So that accidentally fucking happened. Masters of the Universe, it was a done deal. They were making a series with or without me. By some fucking miracle, the guy who was at Disney who went to Mattel said to Rob David, you should check with Kevin Smith. And that's how the ball started rolling. So when they said that, I was like, I don't give a shit what it takes. I'm riding this project until the very end, because that's my back door into Netflix. That's the only way that I'm getting into Netflix, man. So we met with Ted, who's our boss at Netflix, Ted Baselli. If you get a chance to work with anybody at Netflix, work with this man. I've been in this business, what, 26, 27 years at this point. Most creative motherfucker I ever met on the other side of a desk. Don't belong on the other side of a desk. Belongs on this side making shit up, man. He only creative exec came to my house and sat there on the floor on his knees pitching ideas like a fucking little kid. And that, he was the key. Rob, as much as Rob loved Motu and whatnot, he was like, wait till you meet Teddy. This is Teddy's religion. And Teddy told me, he's like, look, I love Batman. I love Spider-Man. I love Star Wars growing up, all that. He's got toys galore. He's going, but my religion was Motu, was Master of the Universe. He's going, I believed every episode that fucking He-Man was about to get killed by Skeletor. I thought there were stakes. I was terrified. And he's going, and that's all I ask that you do with this. He said, I know that the instinct is going to be to make fun of it, make jokes, winking asides. He said, just don't. He said, treat it like Shakespeare. He's going, I know it's ridiculous IP, but it's rich IP, a world full of characters. And he's going, if you could just treat it the way I saw it when I was a kid, I think we'd have something. And I said, I recognize what you're saying, because I used to watch Batman 66, and every episode I was like, fuck, they're going to die. So I know what it means to buy in and shit. Those marching orders made it beautiful, man, because suddenly, like, we had two pillars that we sat between, two mountains, and we were in this valley. Here's Rob and here's Ted. And so both of them are massive fans of the franchise we're working on. Both of them wouldn't let us fail. Like, you know, there was no moment, thank God I never turned in a script where they're like, fuck you. But I would turn in scripts that were like, this is awesome. Add this character to it. And I'm like, fucking well done. Fantastic. So what a great creative experience. And if you love the Filmation show, I fucking promise you, you will adore this. I've got seven animatics right on this damn laptop that I watch incessantly all the time. They're so well done. Sometimes I wake up in the morning. This is not a judgment on anybody else's entertainment, but I'll sift through fucking Netflix, Disney Plus, Hulu, and be like, you know what? I would rather just watch those animatics, and I will fucking watch them again. They are some of the most human fucking pieces of drama I've ever been lucky enough to be associated with, and it has a green fucking tiger in it. Like, it's amazing. And all the credit goes to Dia, Eric, Tim, and Mark, my fellow writers. Powerhouse Animation is crushing it with the animation. All the characters look exactly like you know them and stuff. Like, they told me they're doing figures based on our storyline, which is called Masters of the Universe Revelations. And I was like, why? Our figures look, our designs look like the original designs. So, you know, but they're like, yeah, but this is going to be the Powerhouse style and stuff. It's a faithful adaptation. Like, the same way that I go into Marvel movies and I sit there and go like, all right, it's all good. Yeah, they ought to change this or this, but like, this feels like the book to me. This feels like I felt when I was reading this shit when I was a kid. That's how Motu plays, man. So some people online have been like, well, does that mean nobody but old people are going to get into it? Not at all. I think it's user-friendly as fuck. I think if you're a kid, you'd love it. But if you grew up watching that shit, get ready to cry every fucking episode. You'll cry out of joy that, like, holy fuck, they did it. You'll cry out of, like, pathos and emotion, because there are stakes. Characters die in this. But we don't willy-nilly just kill them and shit. All inherent and germane to the story we're telling. And the original story, which they were like, you can't call it that, because they were like, it's not a great marketing title. The original story was End of the Universe. So it should tell you how big the fucking thing is, man. I love it so much. The only downside is that people got to wait like about a year before they get to see it too, man. But oh my God, I fucking love it. You will absolutely love it.
And wait, is it the same music?
But we got somebody, the guy who's doing the music, who they haven't announced yet, is an absolute fucking genius. And when you hear it, you'll be like, holy shit. Yeah. Like, based on the cast list we got, and that cast list, to be fair, I saw some tweet somewhere where people were like, you shouldn't have spent so much money on the fucking cast, spend it on the animation. We didn't spend that much money on the cast. Everyone did it for scale, which I was so impressed by.
Yeah,
because I was like, you know, normally they're like, you could get non-union voice talent because they make the cartoons overseas and shit like that. Some cartoons don't have anybody doing the, they have people doing the voices, but not known people and shit like that. Teddy was like, I want famous people because this is mine. This is Motu, and I love Motu, and they deserve real actors and shit. And not that the other actors aren't real actors, but real well-known actors. Yeah. Like, he wants to dress it up as best he can. So in the beginning, we were like, well, what kind of names you talk about? Who the fuck's going to want to do this and shit, particularly at scale? And we got a fucking killer cast, man. All of them worked for scale because all of them were just like, I love this. Like, Mark was like, I was done doing animation voiceover. He's going, but then all of a sudden you guys call with Skeletor. And he's like, how the fuck am I supposed to pass up Skeletor? And so, you know, it shows you the affection for the medium, for the material itself, for the property of Motu, that so many people jumped on board. Lena Headey was just like, you know, when we were recording with her, I was like, you know this? You know Motu? And she was like, I was a child once too, Kevin. You know, so like, it's made with absolute affection and reverence for the material. Honestly, of anything I've done in my entire career, it is one of the fucking like five proudest things that I could stand next to and be like, I'm associated with this.